years on, people have gone out of jobs. With the government regime has made people out of a job. And not only have they lost their jobs, they've also lost their homes.
There's a lot of things the government say that people, that there is no poverty in England. I would say there's quite a lot of poverty in England. I would say there's as much poverty here as there is anywhere else in the world.
If you are born poor in Britain, you will stay poor. Basically, government policy has engendered the idea that if you have money, you will increase your money. If you have very little money, you will stay like that. You will stay poor.
These families live in Newtown, a suburb of Birmingham. Here, some 12,500 people live in huge grey buildings and little social houses. 50% of the Newtown citizens are unemployed. Nearly everybody who lives here is poor. From 1979, the total number of British living under the European level of poverty has risen from 5 million to 14 million. One in four of the poor in Europe is British. They are the victims of an economic model which doesn't work. On the 17th floor of the Brooks Tower lives Jeremy Dennis. He was fired 6 weeks ago due to his asthma problems. Now he's got to survive with his unemployment allowance, which he says is too little to live on.
I'll get £27 now. If I had a job, I'd need at least £180 to live on because of my rent and community charge and all that. Because you don't get no benefits when you're working. I don't go out all that much. My mum helps me out. She does me dinners and that. It's hard to live on.
People with low levels of education have seen their salaries cut down. On the other hand, the highly skilled have seen their salaries rise by 200%.
It makes me mad because they don't deserve that much money. When there's people having the water cut off and people who can't afford food for the kids now, and they're justifying getting that £500,000 a year. It's just unreal.
The low pay policy has been crucial for the British Conservative government, but this policy and the belief in the free market system don't offer more jobs, according to Chris Pond, president of the study bureau, the Low Pay Unit, in London.
The British government believes that the free market, unregulated markets, are the best way to compete in the world and to create jobs. And that means that people in Britain have far fewer rights, both social and employment rights, than elsewhere in the European Union countries. We have no legal minimum wage in this country. There is no limit to the hours that people are asked to work each week. And indeed, there is no right to paid holidays for any British citizen. Now, that has not, in fact, resulted in the creation of more jobs. We've created far fewer jobs, proportionately, than other European countries in recent years. But it has resulted in very considerable poverty and hardship.
Carol Varney lives with her husband and two children on the border of Newtown. She's got a part-time job in a transportation company. Her husband has been out of a job for 3 years. Although she has an income of £143, she can't survive without money problems.
In order to make the money go around, you go without things. Sometimes your diet's not as good as it could be. You know, the kids like meat, but it's very rare we have meat. And then the heating you would have on at certain hours, but you wouldn't have it on all the time, where probably somebody who was financially better off would have more heating and they'd probably have a better diet and that sort of situation. So you adapt to what you've got coming in.
Carol relates her low income to the fact that Great Britain abolished the minimum wage. Low-educated people earn around £1.50 an hour. The unions are trying to reinstate the minimum wage of £4, but until now, without success. Every employer is free to determine the wage he's willing to pay.
£10 a week.
large companies tend to have people come in, financial advisors come in and set a target. The target for my sort of work at the moment, for new employers, after 5.5 years of me being there, they tried to employ people for £3.69, I think the amount was, which was below the £4 minimum working wage. And it just doesn't seem to work. There doesn't seem to be enough people willing to go ahead to try and get the minimum wage. People are too worried about losing their jobs to stand up for the rights in this country.
People with money problems can ask for support from the welfare organisation.
The minimum wage. People are too worried about losing their jobs to stand up for the rights in. Worried about losing their jobs to. Worried about losing their jobs to stand up for the rights in this country.
People with money problems can ask for support from the welfare organisation, the Birmingham Settlement.
Good afternoon, Birmingham Settlement. Can I help you? If you'd like to hold the line, I'll put you through to our money advice department. Hold the line, please.
Tessa Farrell works for the Money Advice Centre. She advises people on how to manage their low income.
In Newtown, there are a lot of working poor. That's people who are working full-time, but probably working for a fairly low salary, but are earning just a little bit too much to qualify for help from the government with Social Security.
I think Britain wants to compete with the rest of Europe. They feel that they should act as the low-wage economy in Europe, not only to win an advantage over their European partners, but also to attract investment from the third world and from the newly developing countries on the Pacific Rim, such as Taiwan and South Korea. So that we recently had a report in the French newspaper, Le Monde, telling us that, with quotes from Taiwanese and South Korean industrialists, telling us that they were coming to Britain because wages in Britain were in fact lower than in their home countries.
Great Britain refused to subscribe to the social chapter of the Maastricht Treaty. This led to the loss of every right of protection for the British employees.
The future lies in having a flexible economy where entrepreneurs can take advantage of new opportunities as they arise, which is as competitive as possible internationally. And the government sees some of the kind of legislation that would be brought in by the social protocol of Maastricht as acting against that, as tying the hands of employers, as making it more difficult for them to hire workers and to fire workers. And they argue that if it is difficult to fire your employees, then you are going to be less likely to hire them in the first place.
There is hardly any communication between employers and unions. The British employers don't even have to recognise the unions. The TUC stands with its back to the wall. The employees have lost their faith in the union. In 1979, the TUC had 13 million members. Now, there are only 9 million left.
We've already halved the amount of people that were in non-craft, which is engineering, non-craft unions. So our numbers are halved, so that means that the unions are no longer as strong as they was. What they could have done 5 years ago, they're no longer capable of.
People don't believe anymore in unions.
No, there's no strength. People, the unions themselves, in number, are so down. They no longer take... They no longer seem to have the power. They no longer seem to have the ability that they used to hold years ago. If the union said, the company will do this, the company did it. Now the unions say, oh, if the company say that's okay, that's what we're going to do.
I think the government would not at all argue that its policy had been intended to increase social exclusion. It would argue perhaps that the position might have been worse if it had not liberalised the labour market and if the trade unions had remained strong. It has been more concerned, for instance, to keep down the level of government spending so that the level of taxation can be kept down. And again, it sees that as being part of that a low level of taxation will bring benefits to the enterprise economy. It will make it easier for firms to make profits and to reinvest them, and therefore in the long run to create employment, which will benefit the whole community. But I think what's very, this has been called, one of the names that has been given, this is the trickle-down theory, that if things go well at the top, then eventually the benefits of that will trickle down to the bottom. Well, I think what is now very clear from what's the statistics we have on what's happened in Britain since the late 1970s is that that has not yet happened.
Although the number of poorly educated, unemployed people is still rising, the British government keeps cutting down on welfare budgets. Here lives Loretta Matthews. She's a single parent. Together with her four children, she tries to survive with £121 a week. Too little, she says. She's obliged to lend money from loan sharks, people who lend you money with rates of up to 4,000%. Rita can't pay the money that she lent back. She often lives in a scary situation.
They would send someone that you call a bailiff that would come out and hassle you, sort of. Some of them's all right. Some of them would just, you know, they have like a court order to come in and take things from your home, you know, that would cover the cost of whatever. And then that's it. Some, you know, you get some that sort of maybe take the law in their own hand and come out and, you know, hassle you. You know, sometimes you'd have to fight back and then you end up, you know, going to prison for grievous bodily harm.
She can't go to the banks. Her income is too low to borrow money. 5 years ago, there were still 27 banks. Now, there are only four left. There is no money in Newtown. The shops have closed. People who live there don't have the money to spend.
Yep. 59.
Banks and shops gave up any hope for Newtown. Loretta's biggest worry is how to pay all the bills. The only way to pay her electricity bill is via this token system.
I'm putting the card into the machine. Now I've got some electricity. this is based on something that called a budget scheme. This is how it works. You have to go to any news agent with your card and then have as many tokens, you know, maybe £5 worth of tokens, maybe £10 worth of tokens. If I haven't got any tokens, I'll just have to stay in the dark until when I'm able to do so. You know, I'm able to get some money to buy the tokens to put into the meter.
And then you'll be out of electricity?
Yeah, I'll be out of electricity until I'm able to get the token to put in. There's nothing else I can do.
In the last two government budgets, there have been cuts in welfare benefits, and the general trend is for the government to be withdrawing support, withdrawing the social security safety net from people who desperately need that help. And basically, it amounts to the government saying to individuals that really you must fend for yourself.
Stan and Georgina Wallace are people who can't look after themselves. Georgina is unemployed, Stan is on a pension. Together, they have to live on £73 a week.
Our income is lower than what our bills are. It's but we have to juggle between bills, like if we got water and rent at the same time, I have to pay one or the other one. We have been threatened with court action from the MEB and the poll tax people. Basically, they just come and take the furniture if we don't pay the bill.
Also, the British pension system is going down the hill. Rich people are opting for the opting out system.
The opting out system appeals to people who can afford their own pension. What actually happens is they contract out of the state earning relation, state earnings pension scheme, which means there is less money in that scheme for poor people who will claim when they retire. So in 30 years' time, it may be that there is no retirement pension which the government pays. So I don't know what will happen to people who cannot contract out because they're not working or because they earn too little to buy into a private pension. Again, it's helping the rich people get richer and the poor will get poorer as a consequence.
Hi, take a look at the all-new Chrysler Pacifica. 2017 Kelley Blue Books, KBB.com, Best Buy.
It's an IIHS Top Safety Pick Plus.
Woof! Get more than a great deal during the Chrysler Big Finish event.
Poor will get poorer as a consequence.
We have a lot of building going on at the moment. They're altering the flats by filling in the balconies, putting a cage over them and windows, because people get so depressed that they jump off the balconies. I sometimes get depressed myself, but I don't think I'd ever jump off the balcony.
You never thought about that?
In the past, I probably have, just as a passing thought, but, you know, I tend to find something else to occupy my mind. I'll go for a walk. Sometimes I feel that angry about the way things are going that I'll walk for miles without realising how far I've gone. Then I have to walk back home.
Oi! Come on! Get out of there!
What is happening?
They'll go in a minute. They were climbing in the workyard. You see the ladders on the roofs there? They take them and climb into the flats on the ground floor. I would say they're only about 11, 12-year-olds. We've got you on camera now, clear off. See them run off now? Look, they've run. They're gone.
Poverty in Britain pushes adults and minors to crime. Shirley Scott was heartbroken when the police picked up her 14-year-old son.
Why was he picked up?
Because he was caught in a pub. But then there were evidence to charge him, so I had to let him off. But that ain't the first incident I've had with my son anyway. If he can get money, he'll do whatever he can to get it. So what kick do you get out of it?
I'm getting all kick out of it.
Well, what do you do?
It's fun.
Oh, it's fun robbing people's houses and robbing people on the streets.
In Newtown, the police are powerless. They are undermanned and unarmed. In the meantime, they keep on patrolling by car. More and more people are asking for the bobbies to come onto the street again.
There is a high crime rate in this area, I feel, because of the social deprivation. A lot of movement in and out of the area. The drugs obviously attract the wrong type of person into the area. And to get money for the drugs, people are committing crime.
Irene has lived for 40 years in Newtown. She has also been mugged. Now, she's afraid to walk alone in the streets.
When I was younger, I know the change. Years ago, you could walk anywhere, could go out, leave doors open, no one would bother you. And even like 10 years ago, you could do that. But it's gradually got worse and worse. So no one really goes out unless they're going in a group or someone's picking them up in a car or something.
In Great Britain, the income of parents is of crucial importance for the education of children. High-income families can offer their children better education and better chances for the future. The British can choose between private schools and state schools. Private schools are for many people an unreachable dream.
If I could get a private education, yes, perhaps I would. If I could afford that, yes, I would. In later life, if I, you know, move on and get a decent job, yes, she will have a private education. But I'd like the best for her to have a decent education and then hopefully she'll get a decent job. But what is, you know, how can you see 20 years from now? When I was at school, I didn't think it would be like this. I thought I'd have left school, found, gone to college, got a wonderful job and been happy, married and the rest of it. No Cinderella tale.
We have a real problem in Britain in terms of the level of investment in both education and training. About 1 million school children are now being educated in classes which are more than 30 in size, which makes it very difficult for those children who need the extra help really to get that help. The result, according to the employers' organisation, the Confederation of British Industry, is that we have a workforce which is too poorly educated to compete effectively in the world. And one of the main reasons why we've seen the very sharp increase in the gap between the rich and the poor in Britain is that we have this enormous difference in educational standards and educational opportunities.
Not a great deal in here. Got me Hellman's, that's out of date. Back there, August the 14th. That was 50 pence, that. I've got some stotties I got from the food bank. I've got Rogan Josh sauce in there. That's out of date. I got a smashed packet of noodles today. Very appetising. I've got some out-of-date pita breads, 21st... Oh, no, they're actually in date.
Shops and all that and give you food because you haven't got the money. I know there's people that they wouldn't come here. They think it's dead degrading. Right. They'd rather starve than come here.
I get £50 a week. Time I pay my bills, I'm only left with what, £15. And that's it now. And the time I get my shopping in, I've got no left. It's a shame, like, but especially when you've got vents to feed and what they're going to feed on. No. Going to feed on. No.
The first day we opened, nobody came. The next week, about 12 or 15 people came. The next week, 30. The next week, 60. The next week, 100. And it just kept growing. We thought originally that it would be considerably larger than people imagined. But we didn't, in our wildest imaginations, think it would become the 1,000 a week that we're feeding at the moment.
Usually when you come home, we need is a letter or something with our medical card with your name and address on.
Okay. Oh, right. I've got all that at home, but I was just.
Just next time you come. What's your first name?
Mary.
And how many dogs in the house? How many dogs are in the house?
No, just me.
Just you. And your grandchildren?
No.
Are you on pension?
Well, I'm 63, come on, Jules, I've got not quite there yet.
So, do you get some benefits, do you?
When I'm on the sick at the minute.
Sick, that's fine. They take that along the corridor, and then you have your cup of tea, then they bring you food, and you just sign a bit of paper for it, okay?
Okay,
take care.
Yeah.
There you go, one tea.
One tea for somebody.
Marvellous.
Is it Barry?
Barry, yeah.
Thank you, Barry. He's got sunshine with you, eh? Nice and sunny today.
It is, it's great. It's great weather at the minute, like, I can't believe it because it was quite getting cold last week.
And are you a job seeker at
that? Yeah.
Job seeker? Yeah. Are you sanctioned?
Yeah, oh, well, I'm being like, juice money, you know what I mean? Right. Thanks a lot. Cheers.
Barry?
Yeah? Yeah? Barry?
Go, sir.
Okay.
Hello. What do you
have? I got some noodles there. Goat bran.
Nice. They're
going to
make porridge.
Oh, I love porridge, yeah.
Oh, right.
Really nice, though.
Would you like to cook some rhubarb on your porridge?
Yeah. Got a friend in Morpeth who's got his load of beetroot. One from different places he goes for, like, walks in the countryside and he gets turnips and potatoes and that. Aye, great.
All right.
So, yes, since I've had rhubarb.
Very good.
It all comes in handy, you know what I mean? With what I get on job seekers, I've taken like £14 a week off us for water rates. I've taken their money off us for council tax, which only leaves us with about 60 quid a week, way less, actually 57 quid. I even walk around the house with a torch instead of putting lights on. Right, thanks for the tea. Very nice. I'll see you later. Okay. Bye.
Volunteers, write down dates, you know, and if you can help for an hour, it would be really grateful.
We went through rough patch. A food bank helped us through our support worker. She asked them, and then we got a bit of help, and it's all good. And we've needed this, so it's nice to give something back.
You've got to be able to see where you're going on.
Hey, Jimmy, we've never shifted stuff so fast, man. This is grand.
We'll need a couple more boxes to get here.
And there are pockets of deprivation all over the country. I think our pocket here is quite significant nationally. And I suppose that will apply to all the coalfield and heavy industrial areas. We're an area that had a tradition of manual labour industry. Time has moved on and we've failed to keep up with the change in society. Politicians felt we were no longer able to afford this state apparatus of care, and it's been run down now to the point where it can no longer cope with the needs of people. We're doing what we do because the state is failing to do it. All of us would much sooner see a healthy and more caring state provision that met people's basic needs.
I did originally contact Michael thinking I could do good for others, but as I've been there more, I can see I get as much, if not more, reward by turning up and having the crack, and as a byproduct, I'm also helping others.
Hold it. Start shopping.
You're going to have to shout the names.
Who?
The pen's on the side. There's no one in there. Hello, you've got the bread.
The amount of people that come through the door for food is it's something that's staggering, like. Well, me and my own family went from doing all right to not necessarily needing a food bank, but certainly thinking if things got any worse, what would I do? But we pulled ourselves around, we made the adjustments and got rid of the frivolous living, if that's what it's called. But then I got to wondering, well, we've sold, Rolex watches and the likes. Maybe somebody isn't lucky enough to be able to do that.
Ex-convict like yourself to work. The work we do in the community.
Yes.
I started on a Monday for one day, then I went to 2 days, then 3 days, now it's 5 days, and much more do they want out of it? My street, it's all fun.
Never used to be, though, did it?
No.
Because if you go back 20 years ago, I remember this did have a reputation. It was quite rough, but you were all right if you were from here. Well, now it's changed a lot. Now you've got a lot of refugees and immigrants centred a lot around here, haven't you?
If you come along here, go along that road, the park there, it's chocolate night time with fun.
That's not to say there isn't good people here. It's just changed a hell of a lot, hasn't it? There's a big wagon, that's what we need. Want you packing one of them?
Oh, lovely. Loads of pallets.
Loads of pallets.
Loads of pallets.
Oh, let me get a forklift though, wouldn't we?
Donated food by nice shoppers who bought a little bit extra and put it in the basket for us.
Wasn't false. I think we should do. What do you think?
That we should do. Well, we know what we're doing, and I can certainly say we're more of a help than a hindrance.
Do you enjoy volunteering, Jimmy?
Right, I lose weight, get me out of the house, and I'm on the dole. There's nothing else to do. I apply for 35 jobs a week, and no replies off them. Keeps you fit, I tell you that.
It's a godsend, actually.
It helps in a way. You don't get stuff you really need, like, but it does help.
Helps a little bit, doesn't it?
Aye,
helps a little bit.
I'll get me bends at the weekend.
I see you've got to think of your bends.
I'll get me bends at the weekend just as well as you are, otherwise I wouldn't get fed at my use.
Oh,
Because this is really the best deal.
Aye, it is, aye.
Why?
Because you get bread. The Mondays, you don't get much on the Monday, but the Thursday's the best deal. Now you get your buns and bread and everything.
Have you got a letter with your name and address on? I want a letter.
Okay, I see a new address.
Yes, but...
No, Buster Avenue, no.
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 Is that the new address?
That's for INL and Mariana.
Yeah.
So, are we doing INL or are we doing Mariana?
Junior, Chanel,
sorry, beg your
pardon. He had an appointment with the boss, is he here?
Where is he?
Where is he?
Appointment. John and the boss is here, I go and for a shop. Sorry.
Well, look in the box and have a look. To be honest with you, I was going to cook a cup of tea and how was I going to cook one of our things and Mr. Squares and how was I supposed to stay there?
Do you need a tin opener for your tins? Is that what you're saying?
What are you giving us?
Well, that's all we have at the moment because I'm waiting
for more food coming. I'm not disputing that. Okay, thank you very much.
That's all we've got. Do you need a tin opener?
No, get the somebody else, please.
All right.
Thank you.
Can you talk me through what was in the box?
Bread.
It was just bread?
Bread, more or less bread. And the food that they give us is rubbish. And the people that's going to are Russian and all from foreign countries in any way.
If you feel like that, please don't come back till you feel a bit better. Okay, darling? Off you go home.
It's not my fault.
Hello.
He's a good lad, he's just gone through depression.
I've never had a resort to come to a food bank before. I am worried, of course I am. I'm a proud woman. It's disgusting. I've got to come to this.
How many dogs is in the house, Rebecca?
Just me.
Just you? Any children?
Yeah, two.
Is it low income? Are you any
I'm on statutory sick pay, which I'm not getting.
Right.
Because I'm not getting enough. I'm not paying enough national insurance.
Oh, right.
So I'm not actually...
I worked from the age of being 16 up until I was 19 when I had my first child. Took a few years out to be a mum. No, there was a time when I used to call into Phoenix once every couple of weeks and get my eyebrows threaded and used to look after myself. I was a home support worker. I got 110% satisfaction out of my job. I couldn't I couldn't mentally look after other people at that time. I went into rehab to sort my addiction out. And I haven't been back to work since. I'm 34. I don't want a lot in life. I live day to day, owe me rent, me gas, me electric. Just want to make sure I can feed me children. You know, when people go into people's houses and they look around and they think, she's got a canny nice house. And he said, I didn't even pay for it. My carpet doesn't fit my sitting room. God, I've got to spit on me mirror to polish it. Even just cleaning stuff and even just cutting your, like, toothpaste just so you get to the end of it.
Skyline of London is changing and evolving at absolutely extraordinary speed. It is like an accelerated David Attenborough nature film about the return of spring to the Canadian tundra. Wonderful structures are going up. All prices across London have gone up by 20%. In the last year. The result is that we face a colossal demand for homes, homes that are affordable for all Londoners.
Regeneration means money for the fat cats.
Homes, homes that are affordable for all Londoners.
Regeneration means money for the fat cats. That's what it means.
The original dream of council houses was to build homes for heroes, moving the working classes out of overcrowded slums and into revolutionary architecture, offering running water and futuristic streets in the sky.
When we come here, I took to it in a minute, when I was looking out there and see all that green, oh, I thought, ain't it lovely?
Well, at night time, it's just like, exactly like fairyland.
I was looking out there and see all that green. Oh, I thought, ain't it lovely?
Well, of a night time, it's just like, exactly like fairyland.
But today, the post-war dream of urban renewal has turned sour. The number of council houses in London has fallen by a third in the last 20 years, despite a million more people living here.
We don't have enough homes, full stop, right across the entire economy. That affects everyone. There's a real pinch point with affordability, and we certainly don't have enough affordable homes.
The council estates we do have are gradually being emptied. People are being forced out by local councils to allow for redevelopment of the land. The highest bidders are winning, but the people are fighting back.
All they give a shit about is making fucking money.
In recent months, a group of London mums have started a campaign for truly affordable housing. Their campaign has caught the imagination of the media and public alike and has sparked fires all across the city. One of the areas undergoing a lot of regeneration at the moment is East London. The borough of Newham has a housing waiting list of over 16,000 people. The council have said that because the refurbishment is too expensive, the estate is no longer viable and they are currently seeking a partner to help finance the regeneration. In the meantime, people are being rehoused in temporary accommodation where waiting lists are long, or they're moved into towns far away from London.
In 2013, my mum's sister and I were evicted from our family home of 13 years. We had to declare ourselves statutory homeless and then move into temporary accommodation, where we were waiting for a year. It was a really, really tough time. Being told that you had to wait in order to have somewhere to live. So when I see lots and lots of empty homes like this going unlived in, it really, really strikes a chord with me.
I'm standing on the 22nd floor of one of the tower blocks on the Carpenter's Estate in Stratford. It's only up here that you can see why it's become such prime real estate. We've got Westfield Shopping Centre. We've got 10 train lines, so insanely good transport links. And then round the corner is the Olympic site. And if you come through here, this is what's happened to the flat. I think like 2006, families started being moved out. And now it's pretty much like desolate. And this is just an example of what's happening on every single floor. It actually could be the homes of 134 families, but currently there's only 31 flats being used. All the rest are just like locked up. If you look through the keyhole, you can see that through the big window, directly opposite, an amazing view of the Olympic Park. There's all mats down as well, carpet. These aren't empty shells. This was someone's home. You know, so there's been a family that have chosen that carpet. Chosen the wallpaper and they've made a home. Chris, if you come and see this, just gun shop, won't be long. 12th of the 1st 2006. That's a long time that these flats have been empty. Just seems such a shame when we hear from politicians and newspapers that we're in the midst of a housing crisis. There just aren't enough homes, that there are all these flats on numerous floors that are going unlived in. This video was designed for a Chinese expo in 2010, offering up 1,000 hectares of Newham land as an investment opportunity.
It's interesting, isn't it, seeing the amount of luxury home development. The developers who are building them make the biggest profit. From a local government point of view, if it's on land that they own, that's the way that they get the biggest capital receipt. And local authorities in London, as everywhere else in the country, are under huge financial pressure. It's not a surprise that they want to make the best use of the assets. I do think it's short-sighted though. We need good economic mix. London cannot afford to export the majority of its people and become an enclave for the wealthy. It will not function if that's the case.
I'm about to meet the Focus E15 monks who have politically occupied one of the houses on Carpenter's estate to try and draw national attention to the issue. The Focus E15 campaigners had set the occupation up like a social centre to put the community back into the ghost town. The mayor of Newham, Sir Robin Wells, has been cast as the villain in the mums campaign. Sir Robin Wells has said that the properties are not fit for housing. However, Newham, like other councils, have increasing power under the Localism Act to take advantage of the rising land value in their borough. Outside, I met Jamie, who had gone through her own housing struggles and had come down to show support.
Yeah. So who do you think London's for now?
Everybody. As I say, don't close the doors, man. Everybody's welcome. I'm not going to hate anybody because they have wealth. There's no problem with anybody coming here. Just don't push me out. There is enough space for everybody. It's evident. Like
all the empty flats.
All the empty flats. If you can build high-rises, you can build more. Just build more that I can live in, that I can afford. I'm not saying don't cater for people that are going to come here and invest in the place. I'm just saying please don't make me leave. Or, no, do you know what? No, please anymore. I'm not going. Soz.
Soz.
So after I'm
in the place, I'm just saying please don't make me leave. If you can build high-rises, you can build more. Just build more that I can live in, that I can afford. I'm not saying don't cater for people that are going to come here and invest in the place. I'm just saying please don't make me leave. Invest in the place. I'm just saying please don't make me leave. 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 Or, no, do you know what? No please anymore. I'm not going. Soz.
Soz. So after opening up this property about a week and a half ago, they found out that the properties were obviously completely habitable. And now they've put this sign up, which is council homes available. And call Robin Wells. Were obviously completely habitable. And now for go, they found out that the properties were obviously completely habitable. For go, they found out that the properties were obviously completely habitable. And now they've put this sign up, which is council homes available. And call Robin Wells. That's his number. Jasmine Stone is one of the Focus E15 mothers leading the occupation.
She's been campaigning for council housing ever since she was evicted from temporary accommodation last year.
Where did the idea for the campaign come from? Like, this is going to be a social centre, it's like the centre of Carpenter's Estate.
Well, there's so many people that are being forced out of London to places like Manchester, Hastings and Birmingham. So we thought we'd highlight the issue of there being so many homes boarded up for years on end. Some of the properties on this estate have been empty for over 8 years. I'll show you the show
flat. This would have been a one-bedroom flat. This would have been the first bedroom.
This is crazy.
This would have been the living room. The wallpaper was already here, the carpet and the rug were here, and we put in the furniture.
After we'd lived in a hostel and they gave us a flat, this is, like, better than when we first moved in. So you've got ideal view here.
Yeah, this is in the shadow of the Olympic Park. It's obvious what's happening. Like, they're trying to demolish everything, and if you have a look around, you see all these big, giant glass buildings that nobody can afford in the local area. Since this occupation, we were actually told by the council that we prevented them putting people in here. They've been empty for 8 years, and apparently we were the ones that stopped them over the last 2 weeks.
It's basically just saying that...
They've been empty for 8 years, and apparently we were the ones that stopped them over the last 2 weeks. In here. They've been empty for 8 years, and we're actually told by the council that we prevented them putting people in here. They've been empty for 8 years, and apparently we were the ones that stopped them over the last 2 weeks.
It's basically just saying that your land is worth more than you.
Yeah, exactly. There's people that have created memories here, and they've given birth to their children, and these homes are people's life. Well, by taking someone's home away from them, it's taking their life away.
The mothers weren't the only ones wanting to stay in London. 15-year-old Saffron had also joined the fight back.
No 15 or 14-year-old should actually think, fuck, we're getting moved out of London. They should be going to school, they should be playing with their friends and doing what they want. Where the hell am I going to be put? Am I going to be living on the street? Am I going to be in a care home? No one wants to live in a council property. Absolutely no one, but if that's all you're given, then that's what you're going to make home, and it's to take it away from someone. Am I going to be in a care home? No one wants to live in a council property. Absolutely no one, but if that's all you're given, then that's what you're going to make home, and it's to take it away from someone, that's not fair.
This campaign, there was something so new and so fresh about it. First of all, they've shown that there are homes, people just need to be put in them. Then they've wiped away the excuse of Robin Wells, who said that they were unlivable, because if you look around, people could make a home there. In a situation when you do feel desperate and alone, these mums represent something really, really inspiring and really, really exciting, because they're actually fighting back.
Repopulate the Carpenter's Estate! Repopulate the Carpenter's Estate!
The occupation attracted the attention of two local councillors who decided to come down and show their face.
Social rent is probably about 50%, half of market rents. There's 24,000 people in this borough out of 300,000 households who are in desperate housing need.
And it's a huge number, isn't it?
It's a huge number, the biggest. 100,000 households.
...who decided to come down and show their face.
Social rent is probably about 50%, half of market rents. There's 24,000 people in this borough, out of 300,000 households. Who are in desperate housing need.
And it's a huge number, isn't it?
It's a huge number. The big issue is there is a housing crisis in London, in this country, and it's an affordability crisis. If you've got money, you can find somewhere to live. If you haven't got money, you've got nowhere to live. If we're going to get build homes that these young people and their children want and deserve at a price they can afford. Well, somebody's going to have to pay for that.
The wider problem is recycling, and when properties become vacant, getting them ready and getting the legal possibility for people to come in and live there.
After occupying the building for a week and a half, the Focus E15 mothers were handed an eviction notice from the council. With council estates quickly becoming prime real estate, I wanted to go to the decision-making epicentre to try and meet some of the big dogs who have the power to turn council housing into glossy mega towers.
Today is the day of MIPIM, which is the property trade fair in Kensington Olympia. There's going to be a keynote speech by Boris Johnson to like kickstart it all off. There's going to be property developers there. So I'm getting my glad rags on. I feel like Eliza Doolittle from My Fair Lady, and I'm going to get in there, look all posh. And then I'll drink champagne and suddenly like fall over on a table. This is going to be so fun.
It's way to MIPIM UK. Lovely.
2014 was the first year MIPIM, usually held in Cannes, was hosted in London. This is where developers, councillors and investors network and strike deals. Outside, there was a counter hashtag Block Boris demo led by different housing action groups to try and stop the conference from going ahead.
Outside, you can already see the hashtag Block Boris campaign, which is basically all the people that I've met so far, they're all out there. There's people from like the E15 mums and from Carpenter's Estate. I'm about to walk past them and go inside.
On the inside, it was like a completely separate world, like a boozy property Disneyland.
Basically, they're obviously trying to buy my love because at every storm, there's something delicious. Great,
there you go.
Thank you.
No worries.
Cheers.
There is a kind of great plan to improve housing, to look at these areas that have traditionally been pretty shoddy, like Elephant Castle, and really bring it up. So London is 21st century.
How do you describe the Heyday?
Quite a dangerous place to be over the years, and certainly at the end of its viable life.
What makes something bad?
Well, a large estate or a large piece of land might need to be propped up by valuable uses, and that valuable use might be private residential, it might be office space, it might be retail space or restaurant. So it's whatever makes the most money at that particular point.
All spruced up for Boris, I took my seat for his well-rehearsed sermon.
Then the Mayor of London, Boris Johnson.
Good morning, everybody. I'm delighted to see you here in London, as our host has very kindly said already, of the property capital of the world. I thought MIPIM meant, MIPIM is, was it men in property in the Mediterranean? Said already of the property capital of you here in London, as our host has very kindly said already of the property capital of the world. I thought MIPIM meant, MIPIM is, was it men in property in the Mediterranean, or meet me in the pool in a minute, I thought was what MIPIM stands for. Are they listening outside as well? I sincerely hope they are. All prices across London have gone up by 20% in the last year, according to the Financial Times. And I think you'll agree that is in many ways a compliment to London. It's a sign of success, isn't it? And I just say, finally, to all those slightly xenophobic left-wing commentators some of whom seem to be assembled outside, apparently. I haven't seen them, though. They didn't seem to know when I turned up. I don't want necessarily to kick... I don't want at all to expel any oligarchs from the planet Zog. And I stress, most of my relatives turn out to come from Zog anyway. London thrives on being an international city. We need to welcome international investment to our city.
Boris wasn't alone in getting excited about foreign investment into the capital. Soaring house prices mean that London property is now considered a safe investment all over the world. It's estimated that around two-thirds of new homes in the city are bought up by foreign investors. This brings heavy competition to the buyer's market, making land value skyrocket to record levels.
London is a world city. People want to be here. It's one of the economic drivers of our country. If you need an income of $100,000 or more a year, as is now the case, if you want to be a first-time buyer, then very soon people will just not be able to afford to live here.
The consultants, the lawyers, we've got to build homes for hundreds of thousands of people. The hundreds of thousands of people who actually make this city work and on whom the economy of the whole of the UK depends.
The protesters are trying to get in, so they've had to close down the shutters. There's a line of police across the front. A lot of people are kind of looking quite bewildered and confused. I think a lot of people in here are unaware why they're protesting outside.
Get yourself back!
Stay up back! Let's get the rights! I feel really, really sick, like I want to throw up everywhere. Because I feel so strongly from experience for those people, and I understand and empathise with where they're coming from, on the outside. And a lot of people I know, it's really hard to be standing on the inside, schmoozing and drinking champagne. From across the room, I spotted Stephen Platts. He'd recently led a controversial eviction of the Haygate estate.
In terms of regeneration and why it is feared, I think it is a fear of change. And it's a fear of the unknown. And I think when you propose change, quite rightly, residents, businesses, people impacted by those changes are very resistant, are worried about how it will impact upon their lives. People in the profession have to explain what the benefits of regeneration is, and it's not just about shiny buildings and increased property prices. We've got to make sure we've got our rehousing offer right, so it enables people to actually stay in the area and benefit from the regeneration. And to be quite honest, I don't think the offer's been strong enough in the past, or we haven't explained what that offer is.
Regeneration is completely central to London's ability to reinvent itself and recreate itself. It's not the idea of regeneration that's the problem, it's the way that we've done it and the way that we've allowed the wealthy to walk away with the spoils and not invest in ensuring that we also have affordable homes for ordinary people who need to live and work in London.
It's the end of the day. I've spent hours schmoozing, discussing the future of London, and it's very easy from both sides of the story to kind of create these two-dimensional figures. But I think the people in here need to realise the realities of when they kind of talk about these fancy new regenerations, which they're probably really proud of. It doesn't mean that they couldn't empathise with the people outside. And then outside, it's very hard to empathise with the people inside because you just think there are people knocking down and taking homes. I think it's about like having conversation and bringing a sense of realism back to these very two disparate sides, one which is making money and one which is fighting for people's homes.
This is the Haygate Estate. It housed 1,200 council families but was deemed non-viable and demolished last year. Haygate Estate is part of a £3 billion grand regeneration of Elephant and Castle. Aylesbury Estate, just down the road, is one of the largest council estates in Europe and is next in line for demolition. Gerry Flynn and his family used to live on the Haygate until they were moved off to make way for the demolition. Southwark Council had promised Haygate residents that they would be moved onto new homes called early housing sites.
So when was the realisation that what you had been promised initially had been broken?
I think we all came to the realisation at different times. I mean, the big realisation was in 2007. I think when Southwark Council says, right, you've got to move out, and they hadn't built any of the early housing sites, I think everybody realised then they'd been stuffed, frankly. Social housing does not make the developer money. And so on the Haygate Estate, where we had 1,200 council homes, we're only going to get 79 social rented homes. And that's when they're doubling the amount of homes they're building on the estate. It is something that I look upon, and I think a lot of other people do look upon, as the beginning of a regeneration in which we have no part.
Yeah, I think you can see over here a great pile of rubble just behind those trees there. I think that might have been once where I lived. I mean, some people seem to think that it's all to the good, you know, that pretty ugly place. Knock it down, you're doing everybody a great favour. But obviously, if these are homes where people lived and they were the only homes that they could afford, you're doing nobody a favour.
After receiving a compulsory purchase order, the Haygate leaseholders were forced to move out and buy elsewhere. These lines represent where each leaseholder household moved to. The money they received for their homes was not enough to buy in the local area, so they were pushed further out of London. Southwark Council said the economic downturn had a huge impact on the speed with which they could complete the new housing sites. They say thousands more homes of every kind and of the highest quality will replace and exceed what existed before. I managed to get an appointment with the head of the London Assembly at City Hall. Darren Johnson is leading an investigation into the council estate demolitions.
We're there to hold the mayor to account and to speak up for Londoners.
Boris has said that in order to solve the housing crisis, we need to build more homes. That has now become almost part of the rhetoric to justify regeneration of London housing estates.
Well, the mayor has taken a totally simplistic approach. He said it is just a matter of supply and demand, and that all you need to do is build, build, build. It doesn't matter what type of housing you're building, whether it's luxury apartments that only oligarchs and billionaires can afford, or council housing, whatever. You just need to get the numbers up, and that will solve the problem. Sadly, it's not the case at all. We can't just build our way out of this problem. We need to ensure that we have the right sort of housing, and that we also put in place other measures as well, like introducing rent controls in the private rented sector, which could help protect tenants there. we are seeing some perverse decisions, actually, in terms of estates, that perfectly viable, serviceable estates that get demolished as part of some regeneration. Perfectly viable, serviceable estates. We are seeing some perverse decisions, actually, in terms of estates, that perfectly viable, serviceable estates that get demolished as part of some regeneration project. I really do see it as a sort of social cleansing, really.
So if we take, for example, what's happened on the Haygate estate, promises were broken.
It's just an absolute outrage. I just think it's one of the worst examples of what's happening to social housing here in London.
I found a couple of adverts for Haygate estate, renamed Elephant Park, being advertised in Asia. Developers will often advertise developments abroad off plan in order to finance the rest of the construction.
A lot of these properties are being bought not to live in, but as investments by people, rich people, all over the world. We need investment into the United Kingdom, but investing in homes and then keeping them lying empty when a homeless family could be using it, that's a disgrace.
The Haygate is one of many regeneration estates. Right now, there are over 70 housing struggles happening all over London. One of those is West Hendon. Five-year-old Rini has lived on West Hendon estate for over 30 years and has been served with a compulsory purchase order. That means she has no choice but to move out.
So your mum's been told that she needs to leave and move out next year, without a choice.
Without a choice, yeah. Yeah. You know, the old lady next door, they've been here for years, and both of them have said, we want to die here.
She needs to leave and move out next year, without a choice.
Without a choice, yeah. Yeah. You know, the old lady next door, they've been here for years, and both of them have said, we want to die here. This is our home. We want to die here. And of course they do. You know, they've got the community that looks after them. They had a lovely outlook before they started building out there, and all you can see is wooden fences up there, so you can't actually see anything. You've got all day long lorries coming backwards and forwards. And this is what she's got to, you know, not only her, but everyone around here have had to put up with.
I've been very depressed. Because sometimes I sit here and think of nothing else. At my age, to up and go somewhere else. It's really heartbreaking. People don't know anybody. I've got to go into a different one. And don't know anybody. Don't know what the place will be like.
I'm fighting for my mum and I'm fighting for everyone else on this estate. Oh, actually, I'm fighting for everyone that lives on a council estate and is going through this at the moment. Yeah, we're all fighting for each other and that's the way it should be.
How do you think it's best to fight?
Hit them where it hurts, in the pocket. That's the best way. Stop the work going on, it's costing them money. No lorries can come in and out, it's costing them money.
What are you doing today?
I will be de-locked to the gates of the building sites by the neck. I don't know how long for or what it's going to be like, but it should be fun.
Them people, I'm the hero. Them work hard every day. Them are the working class people, them. That's what you say.
With the others distracting security, Glynis gets ready to lock herself to the gate.
All right, it's good. We're good to go. Right.
The police turn up, but the key has disappeared. All across London, people have been invigorated with an activist spirit, from the Radical Housing Network right through to people that have never associated with that term before.
I go take the bus past the Haygate Estate every day for a year, and I just got incredibly depressed about it. Selling off public land is irreversible. It's going to rocket in price as soon as it's sold. It's an agenda. It's a have a London that's a little bit less rowdy, but monocultural in a way.
Back in East London, a group of mums, the Focus E15 campaigners, fight an eviction notice served by the council. Today is the final hearing.
There's already a lot of people gathering. It's only 9:30 in the morning, and I imagine it's going to get a lot busier. Go, mummies.
After a long and heated debate, the council agreed to allow the mums to leave peacefully on their own terms. The mummies had pulled off a huge feat. They'd successfully put a social agenda that people could identify with into the limelight.
This is the beginning of the end of the housing crisis.
All of a sudden, every media outlet wanted to talk about the thing that had been going unnoticed for years. It felt like something big, and ordinary people are leading the fight back.
Here to stay! Here to fight!
I'm not going anywhere, so hey.
Right.
Yeah, yeah. If I do actually get nicked, please someone go and tell my mum about the baby.
When we put profit over people, it has huge and catastrophic effects on people's lives. I really think the idea of social was lost long ago in the 80s. And if regeneration is going to happen, then we need to make sure that councils, developers, and central government are taking responsibility, and that regeneration is about the residents that already live there. Otherwise, who is regeneration really for?
Raise your glass when you're working class. Someone step up in the year cause it's Friday at last. Raise your glass when you're working class.
It's really quiet and like quite ghosty, isn't it?
Everything about your way of life could be about to change dramatically. How you store your money, where you plan to retire, the way you protect your family and home. All of these things, we believe, are under threat. We don't make this prediction lightly. We're simply following our research to its logical conclusion. We did the same when we anticipated the global credit crisis, the property slide, and the collapse of the banks. In fact, in the 12 years we've been publishing Money Week magazine, this is the most serious warning we've ever made. As you'll see in this short film, we have uncovered an unsolvable problem at the heart of our financial system. We believe the outcome of this problem is inevitable, and the recession, joblessness, and instability you see right now is only the first stage of it. Many people think the slump we're in now is as bad as it will get, but the truth is, it's only the start. In fact, you'll certainly see the consequences of this deep-rooted problem unfold across the cities, towns, and villages of Britain. No one will escape the fallout. In all recorded history, no country has ever recovered from the financial position we find ourselves in today. No government has ever been able to reverse this trend. No emergency action has ever come close to a solution. This inescapable problem has only ever had one outcome: financial collapse. You can challenge every single one of our facts in this film, and we're confident you'll find that we're right about each allegation we make. Then you can decide for yourself. Will you act now and take this chance to protect yourself and your family from the catastrophe that's brewing in our financial system? We hope so, because if we're right, you'll need to act very quickly. In fact, the downward slide has already begun. Britain is about to be flattened by a tidal wave of debt. It doesn't matter if you vote Conservative, Liberal, Labour, UKIP, or for no party at all. The facts are the facts. Let's take a look at some numbers. 2.5 years ago, when the coalition government formed, we were already in a huge amount of debt. In fact, the previous government had left the country sinking under £700 billion worth. The coalition has spent the last 2.5 years desperately and very publicly trying to get our finances in order. We've had an austerity budget. We've had tax hikes. We've had the cuts. But for all that, our national debt is still growing at an incredible rate. Despite David Cameron's talk of austerity, he's going to add an estimated £700 billion to the national debt in just 5 years. That's more than Tony Blair and Gordon Brown added to the national debt in 11 years. It's more than every British government of the past 100 years put together. The fact is, when you look at our finances as a whole, the coalition isn't cutting anything. State spending is going up, our national debt is going up, and our interest payments are going up. By the next general election in 2015, our national debt is estimated to stand at almost £1.4 trillion. It's clear, our public finances are in an enormous mess. Anyone can see that. And to some extent, some politicians will admit it. But add in our financial, personal and private debts, and an even darker picture emerges. Compared to the size of our economy, Britain is now one of the most heavily indebted countries in the Western world. That's official. Our total debts stand at more than 5 times what our entire economy is worth. Proportionately, that's more debt than Italy, Portugal, Spain, and almost twice as much debt as Greece. Those are 4 countries already in the throes of financial crisis. We're the odd one out because we haven't collapsed. Yet. But things can't stay that way for long. You see, the only countries that have more debt than us are Japan, where the economy has stagnated for 20 years and the stock market has crashed by 75%, and Ireland, where the housing market has crashed 50% and the government has been forced to accept a bailout. In fact, our debts tower above almost every other nation's. Here are the figures that prove it. That's absolutely incredible, isn't it? Yet you've probably never seen this fact reported in the Telegraph or on Sky News. And the worst part is, even that isn't the full story. Because when you add in all of Britain's unfunded obligations, promises the government has made on things like public sector pensions, our debts swell to 900% of our economy. That's right. When you add everything up, we owe 9 times what our entire economy is worth. Our political leaders still like to see Britain as a world power. But let's not delude ourselves. It's clear to see we're totally broke. It doesn't matter which set of figures you use or which way you look at Britain's debts. We're merely talking about different shades of disaster here. A country can either pay back its debts or it can't. And it's very clear to us that Britain can't. But how did we get here? After all, we were once the richest and most powerful nation on earth. What happened to all of our money? On the 1st of January 1909, something happened for the first time in British history. The government agreed to redistribute taxes to support people in their old age. On that day, more than any other, the modern welfare state began in earnest. The rules were simple. Men aged 70 and above could claim between 2 and 5 shillings per week from the government. But for all the positive press and good feeling, the government wasn't really making that big a financial commitment, because back then the average working man could only expect to live to 48 years of age. That's the equivalent of offering someone a pension today, but only when they reach the ripe old age of 115. So the idea of rewarding anyone who made it to 70 with a handout from the public purse seemed perfectly fair, and more importantly for the government, cheap. It was a perfectly workable policy, but few politicians realised that they were setting in motion a sequence of events that would inevitably lead to the crisis Britain faces now. And let's not forget, at the beginning of the 20th century, Britain still had a booming overseas empire. It had yet to fight in the cripplingly expensive First World War. The economy was on a seemingly permanent upward trajectory. And the idea that Britain could face any kind of decline, financial or otherwise, had not yet entered mainstream thinking. We could afford to pay for a welfare state, so why shouldn't we implement it? But there was one problem. Now the welfare state had started, no one had any idea where it would stop, or whether it could actually be stopped if it became unaffordable. We'd created a trap for ourselves, then stepped right into it. It wasn't until the Second World War was finally over that the welfare state really began to grow. Welfare was seen as a major part of winning the peace, keeping the forces of socialism and fascism at bay. Of course, politicians soon realized welfare wasn't just a tool to win the peace. It was also incredibly effective at winning votes, too. This same scenario came to be repeated across the world, in the USA, Japan, and across Europe. Seemingly limitless economic growth and prosperity allowed politicians to make an essentially unlimited promise. The government promised to look after you from cradle to grave. This single powerful idea gave government the license to swell to a size unimaginable just half a century earlier. The promises got bigger, and so did the cost. In just a few short years, the size of the welfare state grew almost uncontrollably in a flurry of new laws. There was the Butler Act, which reformed schooling, the Family Allowance Act, the National Insurance Act, the National Health Act, the list went on. The problem was, this all came with a nasty side effect. It was immensely expensive. Everyone assumed we'd be able to pay for it forever, but they were wrong. Politicians found themselves totally and utterly caught in this trap. Any attempt to reduce the size of the welfare state was met with often violent resistance in the form of strikes and protests. Or the party trying to cut back, to do the sensible thing, was simply voted out of power. After all, an ever-growing proportion of the population now benefited from the welfare state in one way or another. The safety net couldn't just be pulled away. The government would forever be saddled with an expense that could only grow. And grow it did. Since public pensions were first introduced, average life expectancy has grown from 48 to 80, a 67% increase. But the age at which we retire has remained essentially the same. This has resulted in an estimated £5 trillion worth of pension promises the state has made to its citizens, roughly five times what our entire economy is worth. No one has any idea how we'll pay these. The recent attempts by the government to change the retirement age don't go anywhere near solving the problem. As people have lived longer, the strain on the NHS, the demand for medication, more doctors, nurses and other staff, as well as a skyrocketing cost of caring for the elderly, has pushed our finances to breaking point. In fact, as state spending has grown, so has the cost of running the welfare system itself. For instance, the state employs 500,000 civil servants. To put that into perspective, during the height of the British Empire, when Britain ran a quarter of the planet, the state employed just 4,000 civil servants. If you're in any doubt just how out of control state spending has become, simply take a look at this. As you can see, spending has exploded in a way no one could have imagined 100 years ago. With the idea of welfare being such a vote winner, no government could take the bull by the horns and cut it back, not in any meaningful way. They could fiddle round the edges and save a few pennies here and there, but as population grew larger and lived longer, all they could really do was sit back and let a future generation sort it out. And now, it's come down to us. In 2012, for example, the government spent roughly £120 billion more than it collects in taxes. In a situation like this, when you spend more than you earn, there's only one way of paying for it, by borrowing money. That alone is bad enough, but remember, we also have to service our debts, to pay interest on a pile of debt that's mounting ever higher, debt that we'll never pay back.
So a vicious cycle was set in motion. Politicians realised that to remain in office, they needed to make bigger promises, call for bigger reforms, and ultimately borrow more and more money. This addiction to debt has spread into every corner of British society. Banks, businesses, the ordinary man on the street. These days, they all carry a great weight of debt. Debt has become normal. Want a holiday? Pay for it on credit. Want a new crowd-pleasing cut in taxes? Fund it with debt. To put it bluntly, our politicians, so-called educated people who were meant to be looking after our interests, acted like teenagers with their first credit card, all to win votes. If the UK had been a business or an individual, we'd have been declared bankrupt by now. We'd have been forced to sell our business premises or our home and would have been housed in a run-down flat long ago. We are broke. We have been for a long time. But very soon, it will really hit home. So what's different about today? Why can't the government just keep giving us more and take on more debt to pay for it? That's worked for 100 years. Why won't it work now? The answer to that is simple. The explosion of government spending and government debt has mostly come in the past 30 years. And during that time, it's been easy and cheap for the government to borrow money. You see, interest rates on the government's debt have been steadily falling for 30 years. Here, let us show you. In 1982, Margaret Thatcher's government had to pay 15% to borrow money for 3 years. This came in the form of a bond, a gilt. Anyone with money, be it a rich country or a pension fund, could invest in the bonds and receive 15% interest in return. But over time, the government's borrowing costs have fallen dramatically. Now, the government only has to pay 2% to borrow money over the same period. That's 7 times cheaper than in 1982. And low interest rates make it easier to borrow money. Debt has been getting steadily cheaper for 3 decades. That has allowed the government to borrow more and more money without having to face the consequences. But these good times are about to come to an end. The simple truth is, if interest rates were at their normal rate of 5%, instead of around the extremely low 2% they're at right now, there's absolutely no way Britain could ever repay its debts. In fact, at normal rates of interest, we're already bust, not just in over our heads, but 6 feet under. It's simple maths. If interest rates moved back towards the normal 5% level, our cost of borrowing would triple. Just to put that into context, if our current debt repayments tripled, the government would have to take drastic action, like abolishing the state pension or privatising the NHS, or pushing tax rates back up to 90% as they were in the 1960s. In short, Britain would change radically. And that's just if interest rates move back to normal levels. The fact is, when you're in a lot of debt, interest rates are either your lifeline or your death sentence. So long as rates stay low, you can just about keep things on track. You can service your debts, keep borrowing, and keep the wolves from your door. When rates move higher, you get squeezed, and eventually, you're finished. All of a sudden, you have to find more and more money to cover the interest on your debt. This is an extreme example of what happens when interest rates take off. As you can see, in 2009, the Greek government could borrow money at just 1%. Then, in the wake of the financial crisis, the Greek economy hit the rocks, fell into recession, and the markets realised what a complete mess the country was in. Interest rates shot up vertically, and Greece imploded, not just financially, but socially and politically too. As you've seen on the news, there have been riots, suicides, overnight poverty, snap elections and crushing general strikes. People couldn't get their money out of banks fast enough. Businesses collapsed. In that environment, just keeping your family safe is a big challenge. That's the danger of rocketing interest rates to a country with huge debts. As Douglas Carswell, MP, said recently, Greece might be the first Western country to discover that you cannot keep running up debts to pay for a lifestyle you did not earn. She will not be the last.
the laws of mathematics are universal. In Britain, interest rates on government borrowing now stand at record lows. If we're not at rock bottom, then we're incredibly close. That means the most important trend of the next 20 years is almost certainly rising interest rates. Debt has been getting cheaper for 30 years. Now, it's about to start getting much more expensive. We're now facing an unprecedented crisis. As interest rates rise, our record debts will become impossible to bear. No one can say how quickly things will escalate. Interest rates could rise overnight, or they could slowly and inevitably push higher, taking years to slowly strangle the economy, the housing market, the stock market, stripping us all of our wealth one day at a time. What we can say with certainty is that sooner or later, interest rates will rise. We're approaching the day when foreign investors realize the scale of our problems and demand higher interest rates, or stop lending to us altogether. When that day arrives, we are certain things will get nasty. So what happens to Britain when interest rates rise? What shape will the crisis take? And what does all this mean for you and your family? The first flashpoint will be the banking system. We've already seen this across Europe. This is because banks hold huge amounts of government debt. When interest rates rise, the value of government debt, bonds, falls. Even a small jump in interest rates would wipe billions of capital off banks' balance sheets. It's impossible to say exactly which high street banks, if any, could withstand that kind of hit. As news of the bank's problems hits the press and rumours of a new round of bailout spread, the public will catch on to what's happening. We're likely to see a run on the banks. Picture the scenes we saw at Northern Rock as people rush to get their savings back, but 10 times worse. That's because this time round, the government simply won't have the money to bail the banks out again. But the crisis will not be confined to the financial sector. The next domino to fall will be the housing market. Most mortgages are linked to interest rates. As interest rates shoot upwards, millions of people will be pushed underwater by a combination of falling housing values and rising mortgage payments. But that isn't all. When a financial system ceases to function, the social fabric begins to fray. We're not simply talking about shares falling or house prices dropping, which is devastating enough. We're talking about the breakdown of social order. The important thing to realise is that Britain is going to change very significantly. Things might never be the same again. Is all this too alarming? Some of our critics would say so. Most people think Britain's debt collapse can't happen. Of course, it's hard to picture. Banks look safe until they announce they're broke. Governments say everything's under control until they beg for bailouts. These events often come as a shock to the public. Many people assume they'll never happen, but assumptions can be misleading, especially ones that are widely held. The Victorians thought the British Empire would last forever. Americans in the 20s thought the stock market boom would never end. And here in the UK, during the 90s and early 2000s, we thought we could keep borrowing and spending forever. But if you need any convincing of how quickly things can change, of how rapidly order can turn into chaos, history offers us a number of painful reminders. Let's take just one of them. In the early 20th century, Argentina was one of the world's largest economies, rich in natural resources, a massive industrial sector, so cultured they called Buenos Aires the Paris of South America. In fact, a popular saying 100 years ago was, as rich as an Argentine. But fast forward to the end of the 20th century, and things looked very different. Argentina's borrowing spiraled out of control. As Argentina's debt accumulated in the late 90s, its financial system buckled. Austerity measures were put in place. Sound familiar? Businesses closed, trade fell off a cliff, and investment fled the country by the billion. Come early 2001, the country was in a state of siege, with banks blocking cash withdrawals, rioting in the streets, and the total collapse of government. So desperate were villagers for food, they hijacked livestock trucks and slaughtered the animals in the streets. To give you some idea of how bad things got and how quickly they escalated, you need to listen to our man in Argentina, Federico Tesore. Federico is one of our private network of analysts. He worked as a financial advisor for Citibank in Buenos Aires at the time, experiencing the chaos firsthand. He's got quite a story to tell.
It was 2001. The US had just suffered the 9/11 attacks. Many Argentines were frightened about what could happen in America. It was chaos. So they decided to bring back their money to Argentina. But that was a terrible mistake, because in December of 2001, the Argentinian government created the Corralito. In English, you will say playpen, I think. We call it a money prison. This meant that you could only get out $500 per week in cash from your bank account. It didn't matter if you had $1 million in the bank. In cash, you could only get $500 per week. For 2 months, this madness continued, until the government decided to convert the US dollar deposit into Argentinian pesos. The official exchange rate was 1.4 to 1, but the illegal market exchange rate was 3 to 1. Even worse, this conversion was not in cash. The government created a 10-year bond for depositors. So people that had $100,000 deposit in the bank were given an Argentinian pesos 140,000 10-year bond. This, of course, enraged people who stormed into the banks very angry. I was working at the Citibank bank at the time. I saw what was happening from the inside. More than once, my life was threatened by desperate customers who just wanted to get their money back. I had to talk with thousands of people per day, many old people, and try to explain what was happening. It was almost impossible. One of the hardest parts was to explain why the international bank like Citibank decided not to recognize the dollar deposit to their customer. They had the money brought to do that, but they didn't do it. They basically defrauded their own customer. The depositor attacked the bank, rioting outside, smashing the windows. All the walls were painted with insults and complaints. We had to enter the bank escorted by the police. It was like living in hell.
It's a chilling story. Within 3 or 4 years, the country fell into financial and social anarchy. And what happened next? Well, Argentina wasn't crossed off the map, it still exists. But 12 years on, it's barely recovered. Conditions for many honest, hard-working people are simply terrible. They're still trying to understand what happened to their tattered country. The government has raided public pensions. The stock market is depressed, and the global market steers well clear of Argentine bonds. It's not complicated. Once your country has imploded and trust in systems and institutions has evaporated, investment stays away for decades. Regular Argentines now hoard gold. Endless government scams and corruption have made them suspicious and distrustful. And a culture of short-termism pervades. But that's Argentina, right? A crazy South American country full of impulsive hotheads and corrupt politicians. That could never happen here in Britain. That could never happen to us. Really? Anyone around 50 years old will know that we've had our own taste of financial and social collapse in the relatively near past. Around 40 years ago, Britain entered its own lost decade of economic chaos. Back in the 1970s, inflation ate into cash savings at a rate of 28%. Yes, 28%. It seemed like every time you turned your back, bank savings lost more of their value. Every single day, you became a little poorer. The FTSE 30 entered the worst bear market in history, falling 73% between 1973 and 1974. Even gilts, our so-called safe haven, collapsed as interest rates went sky high. Rising interest rates buckled the financial system. But it went deeper than that. The speed of social breakdown was frightening. The general strike meant dead bodies went unburied as gravediggers joined the picket line. Stinking piles of rubbish rotted on the streets, towering inside Leicester Square. those lucky enough to have jobs had to swallow huge wage cuts during the infamous three-day week. Shoppers scoured supermarket shelves by torchlight during blackouts. That's not to mention the violent civil unrest, where thousands of the unemployed and strikers clashed with the police. For millions of people trying to keep their hard-earned money secure, it was a nightmare. As the top rate of income tax peaked at 83% in 1974, foreign investment steered away from Britain as if it were an island colony of lepers. We were the sick man of Europe. Property and banking crises meant that people's lives changed dramatically for the worse. Jobs were lost. Family businesses closed. People had to dig deep into their savings just to make ends meet. The country was brought to its knees. So when we're talking about financial emergencies, don't be under any illusions. It can happen here in Britain, just as it can happen anywhere, given the right conditions. In 1976, humiliated, the UK government had to be rescued by the International Monetary Fund, with Jim Callaghan going cap in hand to beg for a huge bailout. Humbled, he delivered what was meant to be a wake-up call for the British financial and political system. We used to think you could spend your way out of recession and increase employment by boosting government spending. I tell you, that option no longer exists, and so far as it ever did exist, it only worked on each occasion by injecting a bigger dose of inflation into the economy, followed by a higher level of unemployment as the next step. These words are amongst the most important ever uttered in the history of modern British politics. Unfortunately, almost everyone has forgotten them. For a left-wing Prime Minister to admit that too much state spending is dangerous should have marked a big turning point in our history. But of course it didn't, as this chart so aptly illustrates. In the 1970s, the spend-borrow-spend experiment should have ended. It should have been our wake-up call, but we just kept on spending. So long as interest rates kept going down, there was always a way to put off the pain, a reason to borrow more, a justification for not balancing the books. But the day of reckoning is approaching. When? Well, we can't say exactly. It might be a long, slow, drawn-out process that drains your wealth over the next decade. Or this time next year, the financial system could be breaking apart. It's impossible to say. But we think that savers and investors who are not aware of the full risks and who fail to protect themselves will suffer the most. The vast majority of people here in Britain will have no idea what action to take as they watch their wealth and financial security drain away, out of reach, perhaps forever. The important question for you is, when this happens, will you know what to do? When these events unfold, very few people will have any idea how to respond. Most will see the assets they've worked all their life to secure begin to lose value rapidly. It won't matter if you have £5,000 in the bank or £500,000. It won't matter if you own a five-bedroom house in Esher or a one-bedroom flat in Croydon. This crisis will lay waste to the wealth of anyone who isn't prepared for it. The most horrible feeling will be the loss of control and the confusion. Desperate to take some sort of action, many people will feel pressured into making investments that could blow up in their faces. The cost of making the wrong move with your money over the next few years could be lasting. What if your money is trapped in one of the banks that collapse? What if your invested wealth is stuck in one of the companies most likely to crash? This is about knowing what you can do with your money if the worst of the crisis unfolds. Our intention is not to be melodramatic. But if events unravel as we expect, thousands of people will lose a lot of what they have, and they won't be able to do a thing about it. By the time most people have pieced it all together, or the true significance of this information makes the headline news in the financial press, it will be too late. And that's why so many people could get caught out and lose so much money. It's essential you prepare for these events. You can't rely on mainstream commentators to help you. So who do you listen to? For most people, disasters of this magnitude come out of the blue. But for our readers, financial crises are rarely a surprise. Often we spot these dangers approaching, as we have this one, and give our readers time to prepare. For more than a decade, MoneyWeek has been sharing its insights with private investors. We have helped steer them away from dangerous areas of the market into profitable ones. In short, we have a track record of getting many of these things right. We gave a warning to steer clear of British banks as early as 2005. But when they crashed in 2007, a lot of Britons still had their money tied up in banking shares, and they lost a lot of it. Let's take another example, property. In October 2006, both the FT and Telegraph were singing property's praises. But we saw things differently. Our research told us the market had dangerously topped out. Our message was loud and clear. Get out of property now. Within just a year, the property market began its steep fall, just as we'd warned. We don't know if you personally lost money in the property collapse, but many people did. Thanks to the UK's obsessive property mania, egged on by the mainstream media, many unfortunate people timed one of the most important investments of their lives completely wrong. On the other hand, those that listened to our timely warning had the opportunity to secure their wealth.
Without the catalyst of MoneyWeek, I surely would be part of the herd and suffered great losses through these challenging times. That is a fact.
Another example. When we predicted the oil super spike in May 2006, those that listened made a swift 82% gain. We have a track record of getting many big calls right. We're proud of it. It's what makes us confident and serious about the job we do here at MoneyWeek, providing crucial and lucrative insight on the markets.
This is simply a note of thanks to you and your staff in providing a publication that has personally guided me into safer financial waters during this time of uncertainty.
Throughout 2007, we repeatedly warned our readers to ditch the FTSE, while the mainstream commentators, with great confidence, wrongly reassured investors there was nothing to worry about. The FTSE giants have nothing to fear. Telegraph, 29th of July, 2007. Once again, our team saw which way the wind was blowing. Here comes the crunch. MoneyWeek, 27th of July, 2007. And right before the colossal crash of 2008, we issued a stark warning. The credit carnage is far from over. Our readers had the time to get out and avoid the pain felt by thousands of investors.
I have to hand it to you. You have forecast everything during the downturn, and none of this is vaguely a surprise to you.
More recently, we gave our readers advance warning about both the Eurozone crisis and China's economic downturn, and showed them the best ways to profit from both. Our message right now is that we believe Britain is entering a long downward cycle, one that's likely to be punctuated by a devastating financial and even social collapse. One that's likely to be punctuated by a devastating financial and even social collapse. Our research group draws upon the knowledge and experience of some of the brightest and most forward-thinking financial minds in the country. The MoneyWeek team includes an award-winning defensive asset manager who's responsible for more than £1 billion in client money, a financial publishing magnate and self-made millionaire, one of the most respected financial commentators in Britain, and one man so innovative in his reading of the markets, he now advises the European Commission. These are men and women who spend every day of their lives either working in or analysing the financial markets, but who most importantly do not get swallowed up by mainstream viewpoints. They are smart, independent people who aren't afraid to seriously question conventional wisdom, to stand apart from their peers and cozy groupthink, and to see what's really going on beneath the surface. The fact is that many ideas about investing, which emerged over the past few decades, have to be radically re-evaluated. The idea that you can just buy and forget it, whether we're talking shares or property, is plain wrong. That's how things used to work, but not anymore. That kind of wrong thinking over the coming months and years could be disastrous for you. Over the last decade, we've shown our readers where the markets were heading months, sometimes years in advance. The value of that insight is incalculable. We have helped keep safe the ambitions and financial futures of countless people.
Again, we cite our success and experience with the crises of the past because there's an even bigger crisis looming. Britain's huge accumulation of debt means its fate has already been sealed. We are about to pay for what we've borrowed, and in the worst possible way, crisis looming. Britain's huge accumulation of debt means its fate has already been sealed. We are about to pay for what we've borrowed, and in the worst possible way. If you have any crisis looming. Britain's huge accumulation of debt means its fate has already been sealed. We are about to pay for what we've borrowed, and in the worst possible way. If you have any remaining doubts that a day of financial reckoning approaches, watch the next 2 minutes of this film, and we'll prove it to you conclusively. In recorded economic history, every single country with debts as big as ours, every single one, has suffered a devastating economic collapse. There are no exceptions. For example, during the Great Depression, people lost everything. Oops, there are no exceptions. Drop in the stock market. Japanese total debt. But things can get worse. During the Great Depression, when thousands of ordinary people lost everything, America's total debt hit 252% of GDP. In any circumstances, that's bad. But things can get worse. During the Japanese economic collapse, which triggered more than two decades of deflation and a 75% drop in the stock market, Japanese total debt hit 498% of GDP. That's twice as bad as the level of debt seen in America during the Great Depression. If Britain's current debts were at those kind of levels, it would be worrying. But in truth, our debts are now much worse than either of those two examples. Shockingly, our debt load is now on a scale comparable with one of the most frightening economic disasters of the 20th century. We're talking about the Weimar Republic. Back then, suffering under the weight of brutal war reparations, civil unrest, and shattered public finances, the Weimar Republic's total debt equaled 913% of its economy. Of course, you know what happened next. The government printed money and hyperinflation took off. In the end, it was cheaper to decorate your home with banknotes than wallpaper. Ultimately, the country descended into a period of economic and social crisis, a catastrophe that ended with the rise of the Nazi Party. And that was with debts worth 913% of the economy. Today, Britain's total debt equals 900% of the economy. When you add up our financial sector debt, government debt, personal debt, and corporate debts, our debt load rivals the Weimar Republic in scale. To put it mildly, this worries us a great deal. It should worry you too, because this simple fact alone proves just how inevitable Britain's coming crisis is. Remember, as you saw earlier, the only thing delaying the crisis right now is the fact that interest rates are at historical lows. That's what allows life to carry on as normal. But things won't be this way for long, because the simple fact is, when interest rates rise, and they will rise, Britain will face the greatest crisis in generations. And there's one more thing you need to consider. The first danger you face won't be the falling price of your shares, nor will it be the insolvency of the banks. Those things we believe will happen. But first, you face an even more immediate threat, the desperate actions of our own government. There is nothing the government can do to solve the debt crisis. Better people than David Cameron and George Osborne have tried to get out of similar crises in the past and failed. As you have seen, the hole we've dug for ourselves is simply too big to ever fill back in. But that won't stop politicians making a series of bad decisions to fight the inevitable while they're still in power. They must be seen to be doing something, and that's bad news for you. As the crisis deepens, panic will take hold.
In a desperate attempt to pay off the debts and try to regain control, politicians will cast around for any sources of money available and use almost any means to seize it. Invariably, that means they'll turn to their primary source of income, you. Throughout history, when countries are in financial crisis, governments automatically raid the wealth of their citizens. It's all they can do. It goes as far back as ancient Rome. As the empire crumbled and inflation raged, the emperors raised taxes over and over, squeezing as much coin as they could from their subjects. Back to the 20th century, in 1933, President Roosevelt signed Executive Order 6102, forbidding the man on the street to hold any significant amount of gold. In the midst of the Great Depression, the government basically made it illegal for anyone but them to hoard the precious yellow metal. Refusal to comply with these demands was met with a 5-year prison sentence. That's essentially how the US filled Fort Knox, by seizing other people's gold. Just 2 years ago in Hungary, facing a debt crisis similar to our own, the government nationalized all pensions. In effect, they confiscated people's savings. Can you imagine waking up one day and being told that the income for the last 30 years of your life hangs on a government promise? In Greece right now, benefits have been cut to the bone, salaries and pensions have been slashed up to 40%, and the retirement age has been hiked to generate more income from the population, the very victims of the crisis. But you don't have to look too far from home to find one of the cruelest examples of seizing private wealth. In 1974, the top rate of income tax under Edward Heath was 83%. Imagine how it would feel to be so blatantly fleeced by your own government. In other words, in times of financial panic, the government will come after the people with money and savings. If you're someone who's worked hard, been responsible, considered the future, thought about your family, planned for your old age, and built up savings and some wealth, you are the prime target. The government and financial authorities will never admit this, of course. They will never announce or admit to these confiscation policies. In fact, their official statements are designed to conceal it. And yet, in the end, their actions and the new controls they implement will undermine some of the core principles of the British way of life. The protection of private property, individual freedom, the rule of law, clear limitations on the role of the state, or to put it colloquially, an Englishman's home is his castle. It's not just your home that will come under threat, it's your money, and the outcome could be very uncomfortable indeed. Just imagine the following situations. Your spending money, limited. You set off to take a brief holiday on the Mediterranean. As you go through security at the airport, you're asked to reveal how much money you have on you. You take out your wallet. Anything over £500 is confiscated, and you can't use your credit cards overseas. Your investments restricted. You come across an interesting investment idea that involves buying a foreign share. You open up your online stockbroking account and search for it. Instead of the usual ticker code and information, all that appears is an error message. Sorry, but overseas shares are no longer available. A dividend super tax. You decide to review your investments and look through your latest pension and broker statements. To your dismay, you find that the dividend income you expected is much, much lower than usual. You notice a small note at the bottom of the statement. It says, "Dividend income is now subject to additional dividend control tax at 25%. Your pension downgraded. You're watching the 10 o'clock news when the newsreader calmly announces the Chancellor of the Exchequer's latest policy. It's a bombshell. In 3 months' time, all private pensions will be nationalised, in the national interest, and the government will take control of all pension provision. In Europe right now, in Italy, Spain and Greece, wealth restrictions are already being implemented. These measures have already been discussed amongst Eurozone finance chiefs, limiting the size of withdrawals from cash machines, border checks, the suspensions of free travel between countries. There are draft plans to initiate these extreme measures under desperate circumstances. Considering the UK has one of the largest debt-to-GDP ratios on the planet, how long will it be before your money is seized by our cash-strapped government? Will it be when interest rates creep up 1%, 2%? It's impossible to predict exactly. Unfortunately, you cannot stop the government taking this course of action. Even worse, these measures will primarily be aimed at people exactly like you. People who have worked hard, saved their money, and paid their taxes. There may be resistance, even mass protests. But if things get bad enough, we think capital controls will be put in place once again. Remember how Britain got into this dangerous situation in the first place. The enormous cost of welfare started spiralling. We had to borrow hundreds of billions to service it. We had to pay interest on that borrowing. The debt has grown and grown. Soon the rates of interest could rocket. At that point, the government cannot function. And very soon we believe they will target you and your wealth to pay for everything. But that doesn't mean you have to just sit there and accept it. In a moment, we'll show you a special wealth preservation report that outlines investments you can make right now to help keep your money out of the government's grasp. How soon do you need to make them? That's up to you, of course. But ask yourself, do you want to risk making them too late, before the real crisis even hits, before the banks buckle and the stock market hits record lows? The government could have a stranglehold on your wealth. Our advice is simple. Don't let that happen. Let our research group show you precisely how to respond. Click on the link appearing below and let Money Week show you some simple, practical ways to defend your wealth against these threats. We'll immediately send you an urgent wealth